Hello, my name is Ryan Manack, and I am a system engineer with Texas Instruments. Today we'll be discussing Power 101, which is an introduction to power electronics. Power electronics overview. Think about your daily activities. Which of these are driven by a plug or an energy source like a battery? We not only utilize power, but we rely on it. Take, for example, your morning routine. You turn off your alarm clock, you turn on the lights in your room, perhaps you use an electric toothbrush and pour yourself a cup of coffee, and then you check the email on your iPhone. You've used more than half a dozen power devices before you even leave for work. Even the automobile that you drive to work in has a combustion engine, but this automobile is littered with electronics. So why do we care? Why do we care about power electronics? None of the aforementioned devices work with a dead battery or a plug that is pulled. All of these must have power. So what exactly is power electronics? Well, electrical power is measured in watts and is calculated as the product of instantaneous current and instantaneous voltage. Energy, on the other hand, is the product of power over a period of time and is measured in watt hours. Every home is connected to the utility grid. Utility companies bill businesses, schools, and residences for electricity and charge by the kilowatt hour. Typical energy prices are in the range of, let's say, 10 cents per kilowatt hour. So where is power electronics used? We've discussed what power is and why it is important. Let's now discuss where you can find it. To be more specific than just everywhere, power is used to support the work of loads. Electric motors, like in a vacuum cleaner or electric car, require appropriate voltages and currents to operate. Home theater speakers receive power over speaker wire that is sent by a receiver. Microcontrollers are common in embedded applications. They support the activities of washing machines, microwave ovens, and functions in automobiles. FPGAs are becoming more frequent in data centers due to the performance per watt advantage versus other technology. They are used to accelerate high-performance, computationally intensive tasks like those performed by search engines. DSPs perform signal processing, audio-video compression, speech compression, and a wide array of other processes. Microcontrollers, FPGAs, and DSPs alike are powered by low-voltage power supplies, in most cases 5 volts or below, and range from power levels of microwatts to hundreds of watts. Power is also used in displays to drive backlight LEDs in computers and televisions. So we've discussed where power is used. So now we need to answer the question of how do we get it? Power is not readily available like water in a stream. Electricity must be generated from an energy source, also known as primary energy. Our world is filled with primary energy, which is an energy form found in nature that has not been subjected to a conversion or transformation process. Primary energy can be classified into non-renewable and renewable categories. Non-renewable energy sources include fossil fuels like coal, oil, and natural gas, and are not easily replaced. Renewable resources, on the other hand, are more easily replaced. Common examples are wind, the sun, and flowing water. But an important question remains: how is an energy source converted into electrical energy? Well, this process varies for different types of sources. Perhaps the easiest to consider is the non-renewable fuels. Inside the power plant, the fuels are burned and heat exhaust is created. This heat exhaust is used to boil water and create steam. Then, the thermal energy of steam is converted into mechanical energy by turning a turbine. The turbine is linked to a generator that spins around with turbine. As it spins, the generator uses the turbine's energy to create electricity. This electricity is transmitted to a transformer whose job is to step up the voltage for power distribution. As we discussed on the previous slide, a power plant creates electricity from an energy source. The next step in the process is to deliver the energy in the form of electricity to the consumer in homes, schools, and businesses. Power distribution, as this is commonly referred to, is accomplished on a macro level through what's known as the grid. The grid is a complex interconnect of transmission lines that carry electricity at very high voltages. High voltages are used to reduce the power loss in copper wire. Power loss is equal to the current squared times the resistance of the wire. Since power is the product of voltage and current, for any given power level, it becomes more advantageous to increase the voltage and proportionally reduce the incurrent, hence reducing the I squared R losses. As you can see in the figure, electricity is transmitted across the country at voltages as high as 765,000 volts AC. For perspective, two series lithium ion batteries are five orders of magnitude lower than this voltage. Virtually all loads operate at voltages much lower than 765,000 volts AC. Just as it is stepped up to reduce transmission losses, the voltage must be stepped down to much lower, safer levels. It is important to note that converting the voltage to higher levels then back down to lower levels is not lossless, which reduces some of the benefits of high voltage transmission. Similar to macro level distribution, power distribution on the micro level leverages many of the same techniques. The example to the left is a rough block diagram of a server. The power source to the server is the 120 volts AC or 230 volts AC line voltage that is typically routed through buildings. The AC voltage is converted to 12 volt DC through a power converter, which we can treat like a black box for now. The 12 volt bus voltage, as we call it, is transmitted across the entire server motherboard. Scattered throughout the top and bottom sides of the server are different loads that combine to form the overall system. These loads, as shown, include fans, memory banks, system I/O rails, and CPUs, just to name a few. And just like all loads cannot be powered by voltages of 765,000 volts AC, neither can all loads be powered by 12 volts DC. To solve this problem, voltage is converted to an acceptable level directly next to the load. This is called a point of load conversion. To summarize, just like in the country's electrical grid, a server distributes a higher voltage 12-volt rail and converts voltages where needed. This architecture limits the I squared R losses on the board. To summarize, power sources in schools, homes, and businesses can include AC outlets, which we saw on the last slide, batteries, wall adapters, lab supplies, generators, or PC USB ports, just to name a few. Power can then be converted in the form of an AC to DC conversion, a DC to DC conversion, or in a black box like a wall adapter. This converted power is then used to support the activity of all types of electrical loads.